I need the breath. 7th, you should sign up to volunteer. Do some fun things with the kids, whatever that may be. But you can volunteer to register on the Church Center app, or you can find Valerie. She's sitting over here. She has a flower shirt. She's raising her hand. You can ask her questions, and she would be happy to get that information for you. Next, we have the Plymouth Foster Care Closet going on. You may have noticed it the past couple weeks on your way into the building. Currently, it's right there in that wagon. But if you're unfamiliar with what the Plymouth Foster Care Closet is this is an organization that we're partnering with that supplies needs to families who are fostering children. If you're not sure, the idea of adding a child to your family unit, it requires a lot of stuff. So as the school year is ramping up, they're looking for school supplies specifically. You know, if you've gotten a card with, the things of, backpacks, notebooks, pencil, things, you can deliver that next week. But if you have not yet gathered a card, this can be a really great way to share that love of Jesus to these families by grabbing a card of school supplies, buying the things, and then bringing it here next week. Next week is the last week to bring your stuff. So I hope you all are able to get a card to help these families. The next thing is August 17th. All the men, raise your hand. This one's for you specifically, yes. We are going to have a great time at a baseball game, but not just any baseball game. The Lansing Lugnuts. Woo! Yes, yes, it's going to be so much fun. It'll be a great time to get together, watch a game. The plan is that we meet somewhere and carpool to Lansing rather than all of us men driving separately, because that feels like a lot of gas. We could all carpool. It'd be a lot of fun. So if you're interested and you want to go to the game, I'm not sure on cost yet. Details are coming soon, but you can sign up on the Church Center app. But if you have questions, I think you can bug Mike, and he'll be happy to help you. One last thing I want to share is that because Oak Point Canton is a part of the Oak Point family of churches, we get the opportunity to be invited to the fun things that Oak Point Novi is doing. So currently, they're doing this, planning this apologetic workshop, this worldview apologetic workshop. It's happening on August 12th. And if you're unsure of what apologetics is or why you should be involved, if this is interesting to you, apologetics is a way to defend the Christian faith with a logical approach. So if you're looking to get involved with apologetics, maybe you have conversations with people and you just want to be able to approach in a logical way, in a loving way, apologetics may be something that you want to get involved with. So August 12th, you can sign up on the Church Center app. It will take you to the Novi Church Center app as a disclaimer, but just if it feels weird, that's normal. So those are all the things that are happening in the next couple weeks. So we're going to continue into this time of worship by singing some songs. So if you want to stand up, but this past Friday, before we sing songs, I want to share that this past Friday, we had a worship night. This worship night was not just our church community, but we also had Friendship Church. We also had Life Church Canton. And we were all singing together. And as we were singing, one of the thoughts that came to my mind was that this moment, this night, was a snapshot of heaven where we'll be able to sing with every nation and every tongue, worshiping the name of Jesus together. So I just want that to resonate with you. So as we continue into worship, I just want to give you this verse to leave you with as we're going to continue to sing some songs. It's Psalm 100 that says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Father, we thank you that you are so faithful, you are so kind, you are so loving to us each and every day. Your mercies are new
just sing a song that just proclaims Hosanna. And it's such an interesting thing that we sing this when the Israelites were saying this as Jesus was entering. He was calling on him to save them from the government that was going on, from the things that were going on presently, and how we can cry out Hosanna because he has saved us. He has saved us from death. He's brought us into life. So I invite you guys to sing this song, Hosanna.
Thank you. Lord, we just want to speak your name. Lord, you are holy, you are mighty, you are powerful. We just want to give you glory. We want to see your name in this community, in our lives. Just remind us of who you are. Lord, we give you this time. We give you this space. It is yours. We ask that you use it as you see fit. We pray all these things in Jesus' name.
I don't know if you've been tracking this over the last, I'd say, year and a couple of months, but we have had bad weather luck whenever we've tried to do something outdoors, and we're getting kind of tired of it. So it's great to have this day to be able to enjoy this beautiful weather together, to meet together, gather together in our community in the open air, which is just it's just a fun thing to do every once in a while. So glad that you are joining us, whether it's your first time or 100th time, whatever. We are super excited to have you here. We have been in a series this summer called Faith in Action, and we've been jumping off of the verses that we find in Hebrews chapter 11 that talk about faith. And this passage is often known even as the Hall of Faith or the Hall of Fame of Faith, where we see a bunch of stories and snippets of stories and characters who the author of Hebrews is saying they demonstrated great faith. They demonstrated great faith in their circumstances. We see all sorts of different things that are there, but we also see that faith is defined in this chapter as confidence and assurance. It's confidence in what we hope for, assurance of things that we don't necessarily see right now with our eyes. And we also see that there are many paths, but it's the same promise in the end, the same promise that we land on that God gives to us. And so far in this series, we've looked at various characters like Gideon and Abraham and Joseph last week, and today is going to be a little bit different. This morning, we're going to look at not just one particular person, but more of a story and a group of people that the author of Hebrews says showed a tremendous amount of faith, which he says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 29, it says, by faith, the people of Israel passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. Now, here's the deal. The people of Israel are commended for their faith of this story that we find back in Exodus chapter 14, which is where we're going to camp out this morning in Exodus 14. The author of Hebrews commends them for their faith, but at the same time, as you look at the story, we look a little bit closer, and maybe their faith at times doesn't seem quite as commendable as you might think just from that little snippet of a passage in Hebrews 11. As we look at the story a little bit closer, we may see some issues with how they exercised their faith. The background is that the people of Israel, we can pick up right from where we left off last week, talking about Joseph. Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers into Israel, and then there was a famine, so his brothers ended up in Israel. Just to make a real long story, super, super short, they end up in Israel, or in Egypt, sorry, with him, and Israel begins to build as a nation in Egypt. They were a free group of people for a certain amount of time, but then a Pharaoh came along that didn't remember them or deal with them. Is that me? And they end up being enslaved. And so the people are, the nation is growing, but they're growing in a state of slavery until someone comes along named Moses. And God taps Moses on the shoulder. And after a long period of preparation, Moses ends up being the person who God calls to bring his people out of the land of Egypt. As he's doing that, there's a lot of issues. The first issue being that Pharaoh didn't want to let them go. He goes back and forth with him over and over again. God sends plagues in order to get Pharaoh to let the people go. Finally, he does. And they run into another major obstacle, and that is that they find themselves trapped between the Red Sea and the Egyptian army, because they keep changing their mind, and they change their mind yet again, and they pursue the Israelites out of Egypt. They're coming to bring them back. And the Israelites are looking at the sea in front of them, and they're looking at the Egyptians behind them going, what is going on? And so that's where they find themselves. They're stuck in the midst of this escape. And here's what they say to Moses at this point in time. When they look back and they see the Egyptians pursuing, they see the Red Sea in front of them. Here is what they say to Moses in verse 11. They said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Can we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? It would verse saying, look, we commend their faith for walking through it on dry land, and then the Egyptians couldn't do that. But at the same time, they're here, and they're in the midst of a season of doubt. They're in a moment of doubt where they're saying, were there not enough graves back there? Why did you bring us to this point, Moses? And they're completely doubting God's plan and what's been laid out for them at this time. And they said, we told you to leave us alone. We would have been better off in slavery. As we look at this, we're like, I see not that much faith, but we'll see as the story develops where the author of Hebrews is pointing us. Here's the point from this portion of the story. When we lack faith, we often are willing to trade God's best for what's familiar to us. When we lack faith, we trade God's best for the familiar. If you're ahead down, if you're in notes, if you'd like to take notes, that would be a slide that would come up if we were indoors. When we lack faith, we trade God's best for what's familiar. In short, we make bad trades at times. We make bad trades in our lives. We can make bad trades, and especially as it comes to our spiritual lives. Sometimes we'll trade things that are temporary pleasures for things that are that would ultimately lead to full satisfaction. Now, because we're in an outdoor service, all we have this morning, we have our nursery open right behind us, but we have our kids here this morning, so I'm looking for a few kids, volunteers, maybe in the ages of like going into third, fourth, or fifth grade. If you're if a child wants to volunteer, come up here, third, fourth, fifth grade, raise your hand, don't be shy. You can win a prize. That's what I'm talking about. Third, fourth, fifth grade, come on down. Come on down. I see you in the back. Come this way. There we go. We got two. That's perfect. That's great. Okay. You guys, come on up. Stand right over here. Okay. Have you guys ever seen Let's Make a Deal? Yeah, me neither. I actually haven't seen it before, but I know how it's played. Okay. So here's the deal. I'm going to give each of you a dollar. Okay. Each of you gets a dollar. That's pretty sweet. Right? You buy like a gumball with that or something. Inflation. So here's what we have up front here. We have a series of gifts, a series of prizes. And you're going to have the opportunity either to keep your dollar, or you can cash in your dollar for a chance to choose one of the prizes. Okay? Now, here's the only issue. Some of the prizes are good. And then at least one of the prizes up there is what we call a zonk. Okay? And that is, it's a bad prize. And, like, if that's what has that, you get the zonk, that's all you get, game over, and you get to go home with the zonk prize, and that's it. Okay? If you pick a good prize, there might be a chance to make another deal. Okay? We'll see how this goes. I'm making this up as I go. Okay, so you guys understand what's happening here? Okay. Why don't you tell everyone your name?
Emery. Lydia.
Okay, Emery. Would you like to, let's see that first blue one right here. Would you like to trade your dollar and get what's in the blue one? Or would you like to keep your dollar and go home?
I would like to get the blue one.
You want to get the blue one? Okay, hold on, but you gotta give me the dollar first. There you go. Grab the blue one. Grab the blue one, bring it back over here. Make sure you can see it right here. See it front and center. Now open, let's see what's in the blue one. Let's see what it is. I actually don't recall what's in the blue. Oh, look at that. It's a Michelangelo. It's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. I guess they're coming back out with stuff, and like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is like my favorite thing ever, so I couldn't resist. Okay, here's what we're going to do. I will give you your dollar back to stop. Or you can go ahead and pick another. You can pick one prize from what's left. If you get the song, you got to turn in the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. If you pick another good one, you get to keep them both. Or you can take the dollar and stop. Take the dollar, go home. You got a prize. Good job. Take that with you. It's all yours. All right, Rocco, you ready? Are you going to keep the dollar? Or are you going to pick? Let's see. Let's go with the pink one.
Can I pick like a different one?
You gotta take the pink one. We gotta make a deal here.
Okay.
He's gonna give the dollar up for the pink one. Let's see what he's got in there. It's a 9-volt battery. That is a song. That's a song. Sorry, Rocco. Hey, I'm gonna give you the dollar just for being a good sport. We call that grace. Alright, you learned a different lesson than what that illustration is really about. Alright, Lydia, you are last up. Do you wanna keep your dollar? let's see what's in there. Oh boy, that's a king size Reese's, and I don't think it's melted yet, so that's a pretty good prize. Now, I will give you the option, either keep the dollar, you can take a dollar and the Reese's and go home, or you can keep going. Keep going. All right, that's what I like to hear. All right, pick the next one. You can get both prizes as long as it's not a song. Okay, this is one of those, like, you throw the tennis ball, it sticks to the paddle thing. That's not a song. That's a good prize right there. Five Below, which is where everything was from. Okay, one more. You want to go for it?
Yeah.
All right, she's going to go for it. She's smart. I'm going to pick the song. All right. What is it? I'm not sure what it is. I just found it. It's a squishmallow of some kind. It's very soft and gray. And you know what? I'm going to throw in the dollar, too, because you were such a great contestant. Got all of your goodies. You win them all. You're the big winner. All right, head home. Great job. There we go. I'm going to switch to this. It's a little clearer. All right, so basically, everybody except Rocco made a great trade today, right? But sometimes you make a bad trade. You know, you don't know what's behind door number one, door number two. You start to doubt what God's plan might be, and you trade something that is familiar for something that would be ultimately best for you. And sometimes we do that when it comes to our faith. Sometimes we don't proceed when what's behind the curtain is really a good thing. And God's calling us to move, but we hold back because we are scared. We want to hold on to control on our own. A lot of times when we go alone, we end up with a song, but when we trust God, we end up with the prize eventually, even if it's not right now and in the immediate, we end up with the prize. But when we lack faith, we trade God's best for the familiar. Let's carry on in our story, picking up in verse 13. It says, Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring to you today. The Egyptians that you see today, you will never see." Verse 14 says this, "The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still." So many times we need to hear that message, that the Lord will fight for us. We just need to be still. We get so caught up thinking that we need to create our way in this life. And that causes us to grasp onto control. And when we grasp onto control, we oftentimes ruin things because we are trying to make sure, we are trying to be our own God. We're trying to make sure our path ends up straight when really we have no control over that in the end. But God can do that for us. Even when things go wrong, He walks through it with us. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. So when we have faith, we realize that God is fighting for us. Ultimately, the word faith is the same exact word for trust. And when we think about that word, sometimes trust may be a little bit more of a clear concept to us than faith. When we think about faith, we should think about trust as well. And when we trust God, we are allowing Him to work for us, even when we can't work for ourselves. When we trust God, we realize that His answers and His activity for us is better than anything that we can provide for ourselves. It's kind of like if we end up getting a diagnosis. Some of us have faced these times in life where you end up with a diagnosis or somebody you love ends up with a health challenge that needs treatment. At a certain point, and you do have a say in your own care, of course, and all of that, but at a certain point, you entrust yourself to people who know a little bit more about medicine than you do. You go to a doctor, someone who's studied this, someone who's seen these cases before, and ultimately you put your trust in that person's expertise. You put your trust in what they know, what they're telling you might be the best pathway and the way that they're guiding you to go with your treatment. You don't say, no, I like my treatments better. And I like my knowledge of medicine better. At a certain point, you put your trust in somebody else who you regard as an expert in the area, and you release your own control, and you allow that person to call some of the shots. In the same way, when it comes to our faith journey, there is an expert, and we need to make sure that we are releasing control and realizing that He is fighting for us, and we need to put our trust in Him in the midst of that. What happens next in our story in Exodus 14 is that the cloud that they've been following, the Israelites have been following God, is a pillar of cloud, and at nighttime it's a pillar of fire. And at this point, it's a pillar of cloud, and they're looking back at the Egyptians pursuing them. They're looking forward. They're seeing the Red Sea in front of them. They can't go past that, but they also are stuck. They're being cornered. And God moves the cloud, and He creates this fog of confusion so that the Egyptians can't even see where the Israelites are. And he disguises them and he hides them from their enemy that's pursuing them. And so that cloud moves and hides the Israelites. And here's what happens next in verse 21. It says, then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. And all the night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind, and he turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their right and on their left. So they walked through, and here's what the author of Hebrews was commending in Hebrews chapter 11. He wasn't necessarily commending their doubt. He wasn't commending their grumbling against Moses. He was commending the fact that at the end of the day, when God opened up the pathway, they just put one foot in front of the other. They just took a step. It was a small step. But they're still being commended. They're still included in this hall of faith just because they walked through on dry ground. And sometimes our faith just needs to be a very small step. Just a little faith is often enough faith. We say that just a little faith is often enough faith. Hebrews 11:29 once again says, by faith the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. Sometimes just a little faith of taking that step and then taking the next step is just, if that's enough faith. That's enough faith. And Jesus said the very same thing in Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. He says, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there. Mustard seeds about this big. And so he's just saying, hey, if we have just a little bit of faith, oftentimes that's enough, as long as we're putting that little bit of faith into action. So I love that this story ends up in the Hall of Faith, even though it's something that we can see as being like, okay, that could be me. I'm doubting, but then at the end of the day, I just take that small step, and that's enough to be commended. We see the humanity in it, we see the struggle in it, we see the doubt. But we also see a little bit of an exercise of a small amount of faith. And God says, that is enough faith. You took the next step. Exodus, chapter 14, verse 31, this sums up the story. It says, when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord, and they put their trust in him and in Moses, his servant. So at the end of all of this, when they see God's faithfulness, when they take their small steps of faith, what happens is their faith increases from there. Because this is the fourth and final point. A small step of faith often leads us to more faith. When we see God come through for us on a small step of faith, it leads us to putting more faith and trust in him. We can trust him more because we saw him come through for us, even in a small circumstance, throughout the course of our lives. So when we lack faith, we trade God's best for the familiar. When we have faith, we realize that God is fighting for us. Just a little faith is often enough faith. And number four, a small step of faith leads us to more faith. So when we take a leap of faith or even a small step of faith, what ends up happening is we see God come through for us. It causes us to trust him more. And the next time a situation comes, we have an easier time trusting him with it. And I think God sometimes helps us along in this, especially when we're new to it, especially when we're new to faith or we're new to walking with him. I can remember when I was a brand new Christian, when I just first placed my trust in Jesus as a personal relationship. I grew up in the church, but there's a point in time where I remember I said, this is mine now. I'm going to make this faith my own. And I started walking with him in a relationship. And after that, I started praying about some of the people in my life who really were some of the people from my former life, like before I was walking with Christ, that maybe were helping me go down the wrong paths at times. And I really cared about them, so I wanted them to know and understand what I had just learned. But I also didn't want to put myself out there. You know that feeling, we all have that tension a little bit. And I was a brand new Christian, so I started praying what I regard as a very selfish prayer. It was like, God, I really want to talk to this person about faith, and I want them to understand it, but could this be easy? Could it just be really, really easy? Like, I don't want to have to bring it up. I don't want to have to make an awkward conversation happen. I just want this to, like, naturally develop. Or maybe they'll bring it up, Lord. Like, really just praying these types of things. And I remember praying that for a handful of weeks. And, not realizing that I was praying, like, a really conservative, somewhat immature prayer. And because I was an immature Christian. And really what ended up happening was exactly that. God kind of gave me a gimme there. He's like, yeah, I can do that for you, because taking that small step of faith, just being willing to have the conversation, he honored that. And now at point, I realized, like, okay, that's not how I'm going to pray for conversations to happen anymore. I realized that he might want to put me in a position where I have to take a bigger leap of faith. But he ultimately, two of these relationships, two of the people I was closest to in the whole world, he was doing something in their lives behind the scenes completely separately. And so when we had the conversation, it was like, so this new thing is happening. I just, like, learned about this guy, Jesus, and he's pretty cool. Like, he's changing my whole life. And, like, you know, they actually brought that conversation to me. And it just happened naturally. One of my, two of my closest friends in the whole world at that time, it was just a really awesome thing to see how God answered that prayer, even though it was immature, even though it wasn't really well thought out, even though it was somewhat selfish. He answered that because it was a small step of faith that I was willing to make at that time. Sometimes it's going to challenge you to a bigger step of faith. But as you take small steps of faith, as you take bigger leaps of faith, he's going to increase your faith and your trust in him to make bigger leaps as time goes on. So if you're in a position right now where you maybe you feel stagnant or stuck in your faith, and you feel like your faith's not growing, that it's been slowed up, maybe it's time to take a little bit of a leap of faith and say, I'm going to do something I'm not really sure about. I feel like God's calling me to do this. I have this conversation, talk to this person, by person, mail, whatever it might be, to reach out and to trust him with my finances, whatever situation, to take the job I sense that he's calling me to, but I don't know, it involves some change and I'm not comfortable with it. But maybe God's calling you to something. You can sense that he's calling you, but you're slow to move. And when we take a step of faith, that's when our faith really comes alive and we begin to trust him more and more. And that's what he would point to and say, even though we're not perfect in it, even though we have our doubts, even though we're like, you know, why don't I go back to what's comfortable? And we have those things playing in the back of our mind. At the end of the day, he honors even a small step of faith that we're willing to take in our lives. And he takes us from there, and he grows us, and he grows that small mustard seed and does something big with it. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you work with us in a way that's relational. Lord, I thank you that you are patient with us, that you're patient with our imperfection. I thank you that trust in faith, Lord, ultimately is the key to walking closely with you, and that you do the rest, that we don't have to earn anything, that we don't have to be better than anyone else, that we don't have to, Lord, fight to produce for you, and then you'll be pleased with us. You love us, and you're pleased with us just because you love us. That's it. Simple as that. And you call us into relationship with you. Lord, as we walk with you, we can walk closer with you, just by trusting you. So Lord, even those times where we're struggling, where we're looking back and saying we were better off when we were enslaved to something, when we were serving some other god, when we were following just our own whims, Lord, would you just give us enough faith to take the next step forward with you? And Lord, as you come through, would you increase our faith? Be with us, Lord, as a church, as a group of people, and as individuals, Lord, as we pursue you in relationship. Pray that when we honor to you, that as we sing, we would honor you, we lift you up. Pray that you would draw near to us, help us to trust you with our lives. In Jesus' name. Thank you. just enjoy a meal. And then lastly, if this is Oak Point Canton, this place you call home, this is your own church, we believe that giving is an act of worship. So if, you know, we have a bucket here, but you also give online in the Church Center app as well. And if you're a visitor here, please do not feel any pressure at all to give. We're just so thankful you could join us today. And with all of that, let me close on praying. Pray for the food anyways. Lord, thank you. Thank you for the sunshine. Thank you for the nice weather. We thank you for the community that you are putting together. We pray that we continue to walk by faith, trusting that you have what's best for us. Open our ears to hear your voice when you are calling us into step into faith. We thank you for this food. Pray that you bless it. Bless